Thank you, thank you. Good morning. Good morning, still. Could everyone hear me? All right, so I'm a Jersey girl. I talk a lot. I talk fast. I'm also a lawyer. We're paid by the minute. So please feel free to be comfortable. I'll try and I'm being very mindful of the time. Listen, I work with judges. And when the judge says time, you stop talking or else the marshal comes take you away. So we'll be very mindful of this. But I figured we'll start it off as lightly as possible. So an engineer, a physicist, and a lawyer are all interviewing for position as a CEO of a large corporation. The engineer was interviewed first, and when asked, what is 2 + 2? The engineer says, give me a moment, steps away, does some measurements and calculations, and come back and says, I thought about it, and the answer is 4. Said, thank you very much. The physicist was next interviewed, and when asked the same question, how much is 2 + 2? Before answering the question, the engineer stepped away, came back and said, I contacted the United States Bureau of Standards, and when reviewing it and after much research, the answer is 4. They said, thank you very much. The lawyer was interviewed last, and when asked the question, how much is 2 + 2? The lawyer drew all the shades in the room, closed the door, walked forward and said, what do you want it to be? When we are thinking about the law and our work that we do, these are a few points I'm going to try to address and be mindful that we actually are thinking about things in the law and not just executing the law, but I wanted to just give you some framework for how we approach things. And we'll kind of talk about what is our final outcome that we're looking for based on the work that you all are doing in different layers. And so I'll just reflect on some of these things with our time today. Lawyers are really coders who don't know it yet. My adventures with ChatGPT, AI and legal implications, AI and the practice of law, AI and the law, and then large language models and jurisprudence, kind of our theoretical foundation of legal thought. And so I wanted to be mindful, Melanie Mitchell, thank you again for this wonderful conference, Millie Moses and the other colleagues who've done all the work. Thank you to the support staff who are so kindly cleaning the place while we're in here. That's no small thing, so I'm very grateful for that. But there were a number of questions that Melanie Mitchell encouraged us to look at, and these were two that kind of stood out to me as I thought about the law. By what mechanisms do humans and other natural information-driven systems extract meaning from data or experiences? And can insights from such systems be used to improve AI systems? And another question that stood out to me from the list was, to what extent do current day AI systems need to understand the situations they deal with in order to perform reliably, particularly in situations outside their training regimes, and to explain their decisions and predictions? Sounds like judges. So I was like, these sound like these are designed just for me. Thank you, Melanie, for including them. But I thought I'd tell you a little bit about myself. So just in terms of a background, I've done some research, and now that I'm a professor over at the law school, and I've had an opportunity to do some scholarship on artificial intelligence and algorithms in particular. I'll talk with you about a few things that we've kind of discovered. One, focusing on criminal justice risk assessment instruments and what is the implication of proprietary third-party software that does not explain what is happening behind the scenes, and what are the implications of open source software that is absolutely telling you what it's doing, and it's all terrible. So that was my first paper, Technological Tethers. My next paper will be coming out in the NYU Law Review online, and it's in response to another piece on state graft. But I'm focusing on the Midas Touch, and I'll explain about that a little bit later, which is about an unemployment software that was based on really just algorithm. It was not even really a fancy AI model. But it so terribly made mistakes that it was 93% wrong. And by that point, it had already bankrupted thousands and thousands of people. I've also had a chance to work with some colleagues here at the Santa Fe Institute on just some comments that have gone forward related to the housing and urban development, related to algorithms, and how they are used particularly as arguments within the law, mostly focusing on it being a defense for landlords. The AI made me do it, but not necessarily something that could be used in a prima facie case to establish the case. And I've also focused on legal education and metacognition. I just love my law school. They let me play with a lot of complex things. And my scholarship on legal education and metacognition has been focusing on developing higher order thinking in family law in particular, and helping students start to study what they're seeing and experiencing in the courtroom and as they're experiencing and watching family law court decisions. And then I've just done two pieces on implicit bias and legal education and how you start to teach students to see the deeper thing in the law that's not always on the front page. So I like this quote by Thane Rosenbaum. Lawyers have a way of seeing that sets them apart from the rest of us. In some ways, the special vision makes them invaluable. In other ways, repulsive. Lawyers are much more focused on rational logic and objective criteria to the exclusion of the emotional, subjectives, and sometimes irrational responses to the world. Moreover, lawyers like to show no emotion and possess a particular disdain for the emotions that are found in others, which has a quality making them seem inhuman. I mean, we're already an algorithm system at this stage. I mean, but this stands out to me. I let it slide because he's a law professor and he understands what he's actually talking about. And there's a great book you might want to check out. It's coming out from Oxford Press by James Grimmelman. He is out of Cornell Law and Cornell Tech, and this book is called CPU Esquire, and he is getting into how lawyers and coders do things with words. That was a perfect talk on this idea of words because I've been playing with it. What happens on all the words that are said in the legal system that aren't captured, and what does that do with large language models? So that's something I've actually been thinking about. But Professor Grimmelman and others kind of think about this. So I thought I'd give you a statute. And I teach in the world of torts. I teach cyber torts. I teach technology in the law. I've got legal innovation and technology coming out next year. Assisted reproductive technology. Just anything with innovation and law, they've let me get the chance to play with. But this is just a general statute. Death by wrongful act or neglect, liability and damages. We're a weird population. I love a good story of someone getting their leg cut off. But here's just a statute, right? This is just a regular statute, and it doesn't take much for you to kind of discover that it's really just a really big if-then-else statement, right? Whenever the death of a person shall be caused by the wrongful act, neglect, or default of another, all those such deaths shall have been caused under such circumstance amount in law to a felony in the act of neglect or default, in such as would, if death had not ensued, have entitled the party injured to maintain an action or recover damages in respect thereof, then, and in every such case, the person who, or the corporation which, would be liable if death had not ensued, shall be liable to an action for damages, notwithstanding the death of the person injured. Feels really straightforward. This feels good as a lawyer. How many coders are like, I don't mind it. You've gotten all your, this is obviously one of those things where you've realized you've had to debug many times. He said, this is our best solution. Just put all the clauses in there. But this is really what we're looking at. And not only do I think about law as a science, it really is, my background being in computer science, but law is an art. There's an art to the practice of law. It's one thing to be able to have captured a thought and to make sure you've critically gone through all of the elements within here, but there is an art that happens in the courtroom that you have to engage in with the trier of fact. There's an order that you decide even what outfit you'll wear to sway your jury, what outfit your client should be wearing. How squeaky of a chair do you have that you know is going to annoy opposing counsel? The art of how many procedural law games you should play, how many interrogatories and depositions and material do you dump on opposing counsel that they won't have time to contemplate, how much derision you have in questions that you ask certain witnesses, how carefully you have to talk to judges. There's an art to it that can persuade. That's really all we're trying to do. I mean, really, a really good argument in opposite instances could be just as persuasive as your argument. And that's what makes the practice of law a little complicated. That's what makes this complex. So everyone's been having some great examples where they've shown ChatGPT adventures. I thought I'd share my little model. I do a lot of lectures, and you know, as I've been working on this, Melanie Moses and I have been teaching a curriculum called Algorithmic Justice to law students for the last month and a half. We've had a lot of really good time, and I decided I'm going to play with it a lot more. Every time I give a lecture, I'm going to run it past ChatGPT instead of doing my traditional searching. And I decided to ask, I always start with hello. I'm polite. I mean, you guys seem to just jump right in, but I always like to greet my chat bot. And I said, who are some Black people who served in the military and are lawyers? Seems pretty straightforward. We got kind of a few major variables here. And it says, there have been many Black individuals who served in the military and later pursued careers in the law. I said, we're well on our way. It gives me the first example, Charles Hamilton Houston. I said, wow, that's really true. I mean, if anyone knows who Charles Hamilton Houston is, he's kind of considered the architect of the modern civil rights movement. He was the dean of Howard Law School. He was the one who trained Thurgood Marshall and Pauli Murray and all of these great lawyers that came through. And then it said, there's also Colin Powell. I said, whoa, whoa. I've been studying Black history my whole life. I didn't even know this. Then it said, there's Michelle Howard. I said, that's really impressive. And then it said, there's James P. Parson. And I said, I know about Charles Hamilton Houston, but I've never heard of General Colin Powell going to law school. In fact, the exact language it told me is he's a retired four-star general, served as the first black chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. After retiring from the military, he pursued a career in politics and law, serving as United States Secretary of State under George W. Bush. None of that happened. I ran it a second time. You'll see that there's one and two. The second time I ran it, he even did even better. He decided to go to Georgetown. I mean, it really kept elevating him. It then showed me Michelle Howard, who is a retired Navy admiral and who earned a law degree, serves as a senior advisor for the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. All of that is partially true. She is Black. She is in the military. She's not a lawyer. But my favorite would be James B. Parsons. And the model it gave me was Parsons is a retired brigadier general. And you start to wonder, this is getting a little complex as we look through it. And this is what my scholarship has been focusing on in particular, has been two areas. I've been looking at technological tethers. And this is this idea that these large language models that are being used, these algorithms that are being implemented, have run into some major complications. And what you might know, Dr. Chris Moore from here at the Santa Fe Institute has done considerable work on this. This has been so extensively concerning that it's actually been stopped in Bernalillo County here in New Mexico because of the way it was used. It's actually not going to be put in front of judges because there have been so many concerns. Even with an open source product, even with transparency on the algorithm, it actually was not getting to any kind of outcomes that we were interested in. But the third-party proprietary software of Compass has been just as concerning. So there's a major case out of Wisconsin with Mr. Loomis, and Mr. Loomis is arrested. He is charged and he decides to plead guilty. As they're working through the sentencing, the judge says, I've decided to give you 6 years. And Loomis says, where did you get 6 years from? And the judge responds, well, Compass said this is a score that would be good for you, that this would be the right kind of sentence. And Loomis says, well, who's Compass? I'd like to talk to them. Now, we know that that's not possible. Compass is a third-party proprietary software. You could not put anyone on the stands. It's considered a work product. And so Loomis takes his case to the Wisconsin Supreme Court, arguing that something occurred to him. There's something that influenced the judge's decision, and he had no grounds or space to actually find out what made Compass's decision. Did Compass compare him to other men in Wisconsin? Did Compass compare him to individuals in Florida? Did Compass compare him to other people with the same charges? Compass was a product that was designed for probation and parole, and now it's being used for sentencing. How did you change the code? Because there are different constitutional protections that one has if they are already incarcerated serving their time versus if they are innocent until proven guilty. So what did Compass do in their calculation related to that? The decision from the court was, okay, we've thought about it, and yeah, the judge said she already thought about that, and that's just her answer. So here's our new thing. We'll just tell every judge to read these five warnings. We have no clue how this product works. That's basically the summation. We have no clue where it got it from. It is documented to actually be wrong about people of color. Please use as you choose. The second paper I've worked on is the Midas Touch. And we come up with lots of strange names in the legal space. That's the only way somebody might click on a paper. But this is something that occurred out of Michigan. Some of you may have seen this in the news. And Michigan had a product that they were using that was based on COBOL. And in about 2013, they decided to move off of this COBOL-based product to a web-based application. And as you can imagine, hijinks ensued. One of them, my favorite part being, is that the data was corrupted. I don't know who set that up, but the data coming out of COBOL into the new system, tons of errors. Then there were also errors of actual logic in the code that was implemented. And then my favorite part, they decided that this entire thing was running so well that they could fire a third of their staff and let the software go everywhere from fraud detection to adjudication to sentencing to taking money. It's pretty amazing, right? And it's amazing. They were able to discover 40,000 people who had committed unemployment fraud, and it just began garnishing their wages. People didn't know what was going on until their tax refunds said that had been intercepted until their wages were being garnished. And the response came when they called the unemployment office, why are my wages being garnished? The response was, I don't know. And every time a staff member asked someone above them, hey, people keep calling, the response came back, you probably should work in another job right now. So everyone who asked questions was pushed to the side, and they discovered that this product was operating without any human intervention at all, and then it had lots of fun. It started emailing people at the unemployment agency web portal who hadn't checked the portal in 4 and 5 years saying, hey, you committed fraud. And it was little things, things that would make you laugh, in terms of just clicking a series of answers in a particular order was enough to trigger unemployment fraud. It was wrong 93% of the time. So we've been looking at some of these things and they keep popping up in lots of different spaces. We're watching now about child welfare algorithms that are facing Department of Justice scrutiny because the algorithms are saying that persons with mental illness are flags that need to be watched over and their children should be taken from them. We're even seeing some of these algorithms being used in child custody cases across the United States in terms of their wellness, whether or not they should have their children. We're watching for racially biased medical algorithms prioritizing white patients over black patients. We're watching on this new lawsuit that's just come out across Workday claiming that their AI and screening tools discriminate against black people, the disabled, and people over 40. As they're applying for jobs. But the complexity that we run into in the law is we've got to figure out what cause of action. That is what we're trying to discover. What is the appropriate legal redress that can be used to address a person's concern? And we've only got a few categories to work with. That's why I love to teach torts and cyber torts. We can only play across the spectrum. We're going to look at culpability. We'll look at fault. We look at blame. We try to determine where it should be. And under strict liability causes of action that we can use, we're really just locked into this. Something went wrong. We're not going to look at your intent. We're not going to look at any kind of other issues. It's just a no-fault kind of thing, and I'll talk about that a little more. We have negligence where we anticipate that a defendant knows that something might happen. The defendant knows there's a risk of their conduct. We look at recklessness. This in some states will be called gross negligence. And it's this idea that it's somewhere between intent, which is the defendant knows there's a risk of their harm, or recklessness, they know it's very likely to happen. And when we are playing with culpability, I wanted to show you this flowchart because I think you're only some of the few people in the world that'll appreciate it. My students never do. I don't know why, but that's okay. But this is what we're trying to do, right? This is all I've got. This is all I've got to work with to be in search of the right cause of action to address the right defendant and figure out what to do with it. Professor Eugene Volokh has published, or he's got a very rough draft. I liked how he published this title. That just came out March 27th, and I think you'll all be very intrigued with it because he's looking directly at large libel models, liability for AI output. Glad you guys didn't see this before I was already invited, so I'm glad I made the cut. So this is kind of interesting, right? Because he's looking at what do we have available under the law in order to address what is happening with large language models, what's happening with AI. And I'll explain why this topic kind of caught his attention. A couple of things have happened recently. Hopefully you've seen this in the news, but this is an Australian mayor who is actually readying what we believe might be the first defamation lawsuit over ChatGPT content. He was quite intrigued when he discovered that he had committed a number of crimes, a ton of crimes. And this is just an individual living his basic life and ran his name through the query. How many times have you all Googled yourself? Hey, I'm up for tenure, I'm doing it all the time, trying to make sure that my CV is updated, right? But what he discovered when he put his information in as people contacted him is that the ChatGPT was defaming his character. We'll talk a little bit about what those elements mean if you'd like as we go forward. But what caught Professor Volokh's attention was what occurred to his colleague and friend, Professor Jonathan Turley. Professor Turley discovered because his friends contacted him that said, hey, I think we need to talk, friend. Well, why is that? Well, because Professor Volokh, in a random study he was doing, asked this question of ChatGPT. Are there any law professors who have been involved in sexual harassment scandals? And can you give the exact examples? And I said, I absolutely can. You got to check out this dude, Jonathan Turley. You've got to see what he did. In fact, here are several Washington Post articles describing exactly what he did in detail with quotes. Professor Bollock called his friend and said, friend, do we need to talk? And he's like, I'm not sure because I've never been to Alaska. The article that it found on the Washington Post said it was 35 students he took to Alaska that he sexually harassed, and that's the case based on him. He said, I've never been to Alaska. I've never been anywhere with 35 students, and that article doesn't actually exist. Within weeks, as you can see, Professor Volokh began to craft this notion of what are our options available in terms of this question of who is liable? Who do we hold responsible if I have been harmed by AI? So Professor Volokh presents this first issue that I think is pretty interesting. I just gave a talk at, I'll be giving a talk for the New Mexico Federal Bar this Friday. I gave one last week to, in of courts here in Santa Fe on Section 230. And this is the case that's been before the United States Supreme Court in which Justice Kagan said, it's not like we're the nine greatest experts on the internet here. I said, oh no, this isn't going to go well. once that was out, I said, I'm very concerned. And there's right reason for that, right? We have individuals who have no clue how any of this works making decisions. And I'll talk about how that impacts jurisprudence. But this big question of Section 230 stands out because Section 230 requires that it be an internet or some kind of technology system that is publishing to a third party. Or information about third party, right? We need all three of those things. And what is really at question with Section 230 is publication. And there's all kinds of fun cases related to this. There's really important reasons we have Section 230. There are really grave concerns about what it is now, where it needs to go. But in terms of this idea of publication, we need that person to have created. This is how Google and so many others have been able to just say, hey, we just, you know, post what others have put up. We just post whatever they put up. This is that shield that Section 230 provides. And we don't need to talk about the sword aspect, but what happens when these systems, when Google is now using Bard, and now Bard is creating new information? What happens when Google has been modifying, if my website says, I love photosynthesis, and Google now posts in the link, photosynthesis is good for you. Have they published something? Is that new information than what my original content on my page says when that's what pops up in the Google search? So these are the kinds of questions we're trying to ponder and think about under the law. And we're kind of also watching artificial intelligence and the practice of law. And I also have a number of other causes of action we're kind of thinking about, we can chat about in the Q&A. And so I did like this quote from my colleague online. My guess is that AI won't remove the need to solve hard problems. It will instead help them with the stupid problems, like finding information and summarizing it. And I'd actually, as a professor, like to say, my colleague who's also a professor, I'd like us to be mindful of that, about what is actually happening in the learning process. How do people take in information? And here's the truth. Lawyers read words, read a lot of words a lot of the time. So I try to give this message to anyone starting law school. You can anticipate reading 50 to 100 pages per day, at least 5 days a week, if you would like to slack, 14 weeks a semester. For six semesters, approximately 21,000 to 42,000 pages need to have crossed your eyes or entered your brain before you end law school. That is not including what happens to individuals working in judicial clerkships, legal internships, law journals, moot court, all of these other ways that they're taking in legal information. And I do believe there's a skill that is actually happening. There's a reason a lawyer can glance at a contract and find the sentence because they've seen thousands and thousands of contracts. There's a reason why you've always hear about these senior partners at law firms who can close their eyes and they can drill something down to these very fine elements because they've seen thousands and thousands of examples. What happens when lawyers just get a summary from someone else's brain's analysis of what to pull from? I'm very concerned about this. I am very concerned about this. And you know, I was so old school that when I started law teaching, I said, no laptops, I want you handwriting. You know, we were wild back then, but I've gotten really cushy since COVID happened. So we're now also thinking that lawyers think about words a lot. This is another thing we do. And this is a really interesting article I think you'll enjoy. It's old, 1974, Reconstruction of an Automobile Destruction, an example of the interaction between language and memory. Remember when I was talking about the art of the practice of law? Well, this is a skill you can do. And so if you were to ask this question, what they did in this study was, how fast were the cars going when they smashed? They changed it also. When they collided, when they bumped, when they hit, when they contacted each other. And with just that small thesaurus word switch, individuals had a very different memory of the actual speed they had been told. That's the art of law. That's when your opposing counsel's got to be quick to catch it. They often aren't. They asked this next question. Well, now that you've heard that word and they contacted them a week later, who remembers seeing glass? And depending on the word they were given was how often they were able to remember what they had been told. This is another thing that I'm thinking about with large language models. Something else kind of silly, but actually a really big deal. This was a great case. Some of you may have seen this in the news. The Oxford comma matters in the law, just to be clear. No reason. I think you guys are the only people that'll appreciate this. But in this case, that turned on this instance of storing comma packing. And it actually was, packing for shipping or distribution. And because there was no comma included, the trucking company was actually, the actual drivers were able to win a $5 million lawsuit. Guess how quickly they changed that statute. They cleaned it up really quickly and they just went semicolon wild to actually address that, right? So even these little things that'll be captured in these legal decisions are going to be a big deal. I'll save these. These are kind of the law things within here. But I did want to get to some things we're trying to think about. So I encourage you to check out the White House blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights. I also encourage you to review the EU AI Act, which has been proposed in terms of certain protections internationally. We're going to be looking at issues of jurisdiction. But I did want to just have a few, and make sure I hit time right away. Make sure you stop me. Just stop me. Jurisprudence and AI. And there's this great article called Law Without Mind, AI Ethics and Jurisprudence. This is very fascinating because we're now trying to think about this thing. So in 2011, it was a new Congress that was in play. It was led by one of the parties, and they decided that at the beginning of the session, they were going to read the Constitution so that people knew what we were here about. But they said, oh my goodness, there might be some stuff in slavery on there, 1808. We got to get rid of that slave. So they said, all right, we won't read anything that's repealed. And then they proceeded to play the strangest game of taboo because they didn't realize how many other ways things referencing race, slavery, and black people were included in the United States Constitution over and over and over again. And it was actually, you should watch the video because you'll see members of the House on the floor realizing as they read out loud, oh shoot, I got. Oh, that's about slavery. That is also about slavery. That is also about slavery. And if you think about it, every legal decision has something built within it that is actually deeper than not. And so when we come to this concept of jurisprudence, when you hear individuals that are before the Senate and they're going up for Senate confirmation and they're saying, I'm just here to call balls and strikes. I'm just here to tell you what the law says and interpret the law as it is within the four boundaries of the Constitution, that's not really the case because they're actually coming from legal theories that are based on a lot of different areas. The law is not just the words on the page, as the Constitution says, but it actually comes from the context in which it was written. There are individuals that have gotten to the space of critical legal studies, and some of the things you might have heard about in the news are actually the why of why these things are occurring. We're thinking about all kinds of fun things. Case law is out there. There's so much case law, it's ready to go. Harvard has so kindly gathered 360 years of United States case law, 6 million, almost 7 million plus unique cases that are searchable. You can download it in Excel and organize it as you please. I'm intrigued to see what jurisprudence will do when it is limited to the cases that are included, which are primarily only appellate opinions and don't include all of the other words, the decisions, the steps, and the documentation that has gone into the creation of the law. Each data set has nested data sets, and we lose data when it is all flattened down into just these one final points of appellate opinions. So these are my questions. Thank you for your time.